teman-teman, hari ini Dr. Jillian Patel dari Universitas Western Australia akan men-sharing pengalaman beliau karena beliau bertugas di rumah sakit di UWA dan juga sebagai dosen. Saya mengenal beliau dari acara Senior Dental Leaders di London ketika itu dan sesudah itu kami sering berkolaborasi bersama dalam riset gitu dan beliau sangat mahir karena mempunyai banyak jurnal yang sudah dipublish. Hari ini saya minta beliau untuk bisa sharing ke kita dan beliau sudah mengatakan bahwa beliau bukan expertnya loh, beliau hanya men-sharingkan apa yang dikerjakan di sana. Saya bilang, ya itu yang kami perlukan, kami perlu wawasan dari beberapa negara agar kemudian bisa mengambil best practices. Jadi tujuan hari ini adalah seperti itu. Okay, Jillian, I think you can start and whenever you want me to translate, then I will translate the slides. Thank you.
Okay, perfect. So you should be able to see my screen now.
Yes.
Perfect. Well, good morning, everyone. I hope you're all keeping well and safe during these challenging times. And thank you for the opportunity to present to you all about infection control. So before we start, okay. So before we start, I have to say that I'm certainly not an expert in infection control. This presentation will simply share some of the knowledge. One second, I just check this. The knowledge that I've gained through my general and specialist training and share some of my experiences working in both private, public, and hospital settings. Most of the information that I'll be sharing with you is referenced and is collated from the Australian Dental Association and previously published work. Of course, I'd want to direct you to your own professional and government regulations to guide you, and potentially some of this presentation will help inform your judgment. I also don't have any conflicts of interest to declare as part of this presentation. You're okay for me to continue, Irene?
Yes, jadi teman-teman, Jillian ini adalah seorang spesialis pediatrik dan beliau akan men-sharingkan apa yang akan dilakukan di Australia mengikuti guidelines dari Australia. Iya, Jillian.
Okay, so as part of this practical lecture,
Bali ibu ternyata bukan Bandung. Sekalinya banyak.
Yeah, okay. The first part we'll talk about general infection control principles. Then the second part I'll talk a little bit about specific measures around COVID-19. So first of all, just start with we need to know what infection control is, and then I'll explain a little bit about how we control and manage infection, especially around the chain of infection. And then, especially for us as dental professionals, we need to know the difference between disinfection and sterilization. And I'll refresh some of the fundamentals around infection control in dentistry. And following on from this, we'll talk a little bit about hand hygiene. And then as we move into the second part of the lecture, specifically share some experiences around what we've done here in Australia around COVID-19 and measures such as social distancing, personal protective equipment and management of aerosols and so on.
Ya, jadi hari ini kita akan membahas mengenai apa itu infection control dan kemudian bagaimana lingkaran dari infeksi ini. Kita akan mempelajari apa bedanya desinfeksi dan sterilisasi, dan kemudian juga akan diulas mengenai kebersihan tangan. Lalu juga akan diulas mengenai peraturan di Australia, terutama terkait COVID-19. Dan saya minta Jilan juga membahas mengenai hal-hal praktek seperti bagaimana melakukan social distancing, bagaimana membooking pasien, men-screening pasien, baju apa yang harus kita pakai, dan kemudian bagaimana mereka manajemen dari aerosol.
Okay, so to start with, let's talk a little bit about what infection control is. And really, it's defined as the ability to prevent the transmission of disease-producing agents, whether these be bacteria, viruses, or fungi, from one patient to another, from dental staff to patients, and from patients to dental staff. So you can appreciate there's a lot of different pathways of transmission that we need to control, and it's not just about protecting ourselves.
Jadi infection control itu artinya mencegah transmisi dari penyakit, misalnya yang ditimbulkan oleh bakteri, virus, dan jamur, dari satu pasien ke pasien lain, dari petugas kesehatan, dan dari petugas dokter ke pasien, dan dari pasien ke dokter giginya ataupun ke staf yang lain. Jadi infection control itu bukan tentang melindungi diri kita sendiri, tapi juga untuk melindungi transmisi penyakit.
So the first step of all of this is understanding the chain of infection, because it's important to understand why we take certain steps to control infection. And we'll go through each of these steps in the whole chain. The first step is knowing what sort of infectious agent we're dealing with. For example, we know when dealing with bacteria, we take certain precautions as opposed to dealing with viruses. The second aspect is knowing the source or the reservoir from which these agents come from, whether it's people, animals, or water. And then the next three steps are where we as dental professionals tend to focus a lot of our time. And these deal with the portal of exit, the mode of transmission, and the portal of entry. For example, it's important for us to know that COVID-19 is transmitted by splatter and aerosols, and this can be transmitted by both indirect and direct contact. And then they enter through the respiratory tract. So knowing those three things are important for us as dentists. And then the final step, as you can see here, is needing a susceptible host. We have infectious agents around us all the time, but that doesn't mean that you'll get sick. Our body is constantly fighting infection every day, and because our immune system is able to manage it, we don't even know that it is happening. So in particularly when you have immunocompromised patients, infectious agents which would otherwise not cause an issue can potentially be life-threatening in those patients.
Lingkaran infeksi itu terdiri dari 6 hal. Hal yang pertama adalah infectious agent-nya bisa berupa bakteri, virus, jamur, ataupun parasit. Kemudian dari mana mereka berasal, ada yang dari manusia, ada yang dari air, ada yang dari hewan, ada yang dari tanah, dari permukaan yang kotor, gitu ya. Dan kemudian ada 3 hal yang mempengaruhi di kamar praktek, yaitu pengetahuan tentang bagaimana infeksi ini bisa masuk. Misalnya, apakah dari luka yang terbuka, ataukah dari muncratan cairan tubuh, ataukah dari aerosol. Kemudian yang harus kita tahu juga adalah moda dari transmisinya ini. Apakah karena direct contact, atau dari menelan, atau dari menghirup. Lalu kemudian portal of entry-nya, jadi dari mana dia masuk, itu misalnya dari kulit yang terbuka, atau dari jalan pernafasan, atau dari mukosa. Nah, selain itu ada satu hal penting lagi, yaitu tidak semua orang akan jatuh sakit ketika ada infectious agent ini. Pada orang yang immunocompromised atau imunnya rendah, maka masuknya bakteri atau infectious agent ini bahkan bisa mengancam nyawanya. Jadi ada orang-orang yang rawan.
Okay, so as dental professionals and even health professionals, we need to know how to break the chain, how to break the chain of infection, and that's what we will look at. For example, when dealing with the first chain, the infectious agent itself. We know that COVID-19, just as an example, is a viral infection. So there's no point trying to treat it using antibiotics. And this is where concepts such as antibiotic stewardship come into play. For example, we see antibiotics being misused a lot in dentistry. A lot of the time, people will go to a medical GP with a toothache, and there's a very high chance that they will be given antibiotics without any formal diagnosis or investigation. And we know that just giving out antibiotics is not appropriate and contributes significantly towards a rise in antibiotic resistance. So understanding the infectious agent we're dealing with is the first step in breaking the chain.
Infection control itu artinya memutus rantai yang menyebabkan bisa terjadinya penyakit. Salah satu rantai yang kita putuskan di sini adalah saat penegakan diagnosa dan perawatan. Dan di situ harus setiap dokter harus paham bagaimana penggunaan antimikrobial atau antibiotik yang rasional, karena penggunaan yang berlebihan itu akan menimbulkan resistensi terhadap bakteri.
And then moving on, we know that the source, knowing the source of where the infection agents are being held is important, because this is where we can enforce things like social distancing, triage, quarantine, self-isolation for in dealing with COVID, for example. But if we look at other infections like cholera, we know that it is a bacterial infection, that it is spread mostly by unsafe food and water. So in order to tackle cholera as an infection, we would be targeting things like water purification, hand washing, sewage management, and so on.
Rantai yang kedua adalah kita harus paham ini asalnya dari mana, sumbernya dari mana. Jadi misalnya kayak kolera itu dari air yang kotor, maka kemudian penanganan kita adalah bagaimana mengontrol sumber air.
So moving on down the chain, this now becomes more relevant for us in dentistry because it's what we do clinically every day. So we need to be able to protect our patients, use appropriate personal protective equipment, practice disinfection and sterilization to prevent this transmission of infection.
Ya, kemudian tiga hal rantai berikutnya ini lebih relevan di tempat praktek kita, dan yang harus kita putuskan di sana adalah bagaimana melindungi kita, bagaimana melindungi pasien dengan memakai personal protective equipment yang sesuai, dan kemudian mengontrol aerosol.
And then very finally, in order to influence the host defense system, that's where things like immunizations, health insurance, and patient education become important.
Dan rantai yang terakhir untuk bisa kita putuskan adalah menambah kekebalan dari orang tersebut, dari pasien, yaitu misalnya dengan imunisasi, dengan edukasi, dengan memberinya health insurance.
So I want to spend some time looking at this section because this is where we are basically practicing day to day as dentists.
Jadi sekarang kita akan bahas mengenai rantai, tiga rantai ini, karena rantai ini yang spesifik di kamar praktek.
So in dental practice, the transmission of microorganisms can occur in many, many ways. They can be inhaled, implanted, ingested, injected, or splashed. And the transmission can occur directly or indirectly. For example, a needle stick exposure or inhalation of aerosols. And you can even get indirect contact from touching a contaminated surface like a bench top. And more recently, we've seen a lot of focus on airborne and droplet precaution because of the whole COVID pandemic. And I'll go through this in a lot more detail a bit later.
Ketika kita bicara transmisi di kamar praktek, maka itu bisa karena terhirup, bisa karena masuk, bisa karena tertelan, bisa karena tertusuk, atau bisa karena terciprat ke permukaan kulit ataupun mukosa. Dan kemudian ada yang kontaknya langsung maupun tidak langsung. Dan kemudian tentang airborne dan droplet ini akan dibahas lebih detail.
Okay, so there's a lot of very good infographics and posters available through reputable sources like the World Health Organization. And it's useful to have these around the practice or to give to patients and staff just to increase their awareness of what is happening at the moment. And you can see here the images showing transmission from droplets, the importance of cleaning inanimate objects like door handles, pens, and so on, just to prevent further contamination and spread. And then also the recommendations around hygiene and social distancing. But I'm going to stop talking so much about COVID just now because we'll deal with that in the second part of the presentation.
Ada banyak leaflet yang sudah diterbitkan oleh pemerintah untuk bisa menjaga masyarakat, terutama misalnya mengedukasi tentang transmisinya, mengedukasi tentang bagaimana cara penularannya dan bagaimana mengurangi resikonya.
So let's first look at some of the fundamentals around disinfection and sterilization in the dental practice. The most simplest thing that we do every day is cleaning, which is simply removing any visible debris from objects. And thorough cleaning is essential before any high-level disinfection or sterilization is done. Because if you're leaving these inorganic and organic materials, this debris on instruments, then it interferes with the effectiveness of disinfection and sterilization later. So cleaning is the first step.
Sekarang kita akan bicara tentang bedanya desinfeksi dan sterilisasi. Namun sebelum kita bicara desinfeksi dan sterilisasi, nomor satu adalah penting untuk dilakukan cleaning. Cleaning itu artinya menghilangkan semua sisa-sisa bahan dari permukaan alat-alat yang kita pakai. Karena kalau tidak kita bersihkan dulu, maka proses desinfeksi maupun sterilisasinya juga tidak efektif.
So, disinfection is the next step which is slightly more involved. And this eliminates many microorganisms, but not bacterial spores. And is mainly used on inanimate objects. So these are things like the dental chair or bench tops, x-ray units or handles, that sort of thing. We call all of these objects fomites, which are basically any object or material that can carry infection.
Yang dimaksud dengan desinfeksi adalah menghilangkan semua mikroorganisme yang patogen dari permukaan benda maupun binatang yang bisa membawa mikroorganisme tersebut. Tapi desinfeksi tidak bisa menghilangkan spora bakteri.
And now we move on to sterilization, which is different from disinfection because it eliminates all forms of microorganisms, including bacterial spores. And this usually in dental practice is achieved through the use of an autoclave, which is steam under pressure, like you can see here on the bottom right.
Nah, bedanya dengan sterilisasi, sterilisasi adalah menghilangkan semua bentuk mikroba dan termasuk spora, dan biasanya dilakukan menggunakan alat-alat seperti autoclave, dry heat, seperti itu.
Okay, so here you will notice the different levels from cleaning, which is just removing the debris, through to disinfection and sterilization, which removes all forms of bacterial microorganisms.
Karena itu ada tiga tahap, ada tiga level di dalam desinfeksi dan sterilisasi ini, yaitu level yang paling rendah adalah cleaning, menghilangkan sisa bahan. Yang kedua adalah desinfeksi, menghilangkan mikroorganisme tapi tidak menghilangkan spora. Yang ketiga adalah sterilisasi, yaitu menghancurkan atau menghilangkan semua bentuk termasuk spora.
So it's very important to acknowledge that these are all different things. Disinfection doesn't mean sterilization, and for different instruments in our dental practice, they will have different risk categories. And a lot of critical and semi-critical items are usually need to be sterilized compulsory.
Karena itu penting kita paham dari bahan barang, dari barang-barang yang kita pakai, yang mana yang harus didesinfeksi dan yang mana yang harus dilakukan sterilisasi.
So here we have an example of a dental forceps, which is considered a critical item, and I'll talk about the risk categories later. But you can see that it is visibly soiled with blood stains. So all of this debris has to be physically removed. And this is either done by manual scrubbing and then later placing it in an ultrasonic cleaner or something like that before you put it into an autoclave. If you just put it into an autoclave like this, the sterilization process will not work.
Jadi contohnya kita punya tang yang kita lihat berlumuran darah seperti ini, maka nomor satu yang harus dilakukan adalah cleaning, menghilangkan sisa-sisa darah ini dari permukaan tang. Kemudian baru kita masukkan ke kita bisa bersihkannya pakai ultrasonic cleanser, baru kemudian kita masukkan ke autoclave. Jika langsung kita masukkan ke autoclave, maka tidak efektif.
So if we look at the different risk categories of instruments, you have critical items, which are basically those that penetrate through tissue or contact saliva and blood directly. And these are things like dental forceps, needles, and burrs. And all of these critical items, they have to be sterile when they're being used.
Jadi benda-benda yang kita pakai itu punya risk kategori, jadi punya kategori resiko. Yang termasuk kategori risiko kritikal adalah benda-benda yang ketika kita pakai itu mengenai ludah, mengenai darah, misalnya seperti tang, kaca mulut, jarum suntik, dan seterusnya. Nah, barang-barang ini yang harus dilakukan sterilisasi.
And then we have also like I was saying, because they have to be kept sterile, they're normally kept in bags and kept separate so that they maintain their sterility when they're ready to be used.
Dan karena benda-benda ini harus tetap steril, maka biasanya kemudian dimasukkan ke dalam kantong satu persatu dan terpisah sehingga dia tetap steril hingga nanti saat akan digunakan.
So now we have semi-critical items, which are those that have touched mucosa or non-intact skin. But they're not penetrating tissue or anything like that. So these are things like mouth mirrors or probes and tweezers. And where possible, these instruments should also be sterilized. And in cases where they cannot, for example, the tip of a curing light, a barrier sleeve should be used, and then the item needs to be disinfected.
Yang termasuk semi-critical item adalah benda-benda yang berkontak dengan mukosa. Jadi misalnya kaca mulut, probe, kemudian sendok cetak gitu ya. Nah, kalau bisa disterilisasi lebih baik, tapi kalau tidak bisa disterilisasi maka harus didesinfeksi.
And then lastly we have non-critical items. These are things that only contact intact skin. These are things like the dental chair, the patient glasses, X-ray unit, and so on. These items ideally should have a barrier sleeve or they'll definitely at least undergo disinfection after each patient.
Kemudian kategori yang ketiga adalah yang non-critical. Jadi non-critical ini adalah benda-benda yang berkontak dengan kulit kita yang utuh gitu ya. Nah, misalnya adalah dental unit, peralatan-peralatan ini harus didesinfeksi setiap kali berganti pasien dan harus dibungkus.
So now I just want to share with you a short video that shows this whole process in a real dental situation.
Berikut ini adalah video di kamar praktek.
When a dental procedure is finished, you need to prepare the contaminated instruments for sterilization in the instrument processing room. Remove your contaminated gloves, wash your hands, and put on clean gloves. Remove the air water tip, suctions, and handpiece, and place on the tray with the used instruments. Carry the tray to the instrument processing area and place in the cleaning area. Now, remove those gloves and wash your hands again. Put on puncture-resistant utility gloves to protect your hands from sharps. Place all contaminated waste in the designated biohazard waste containers. It's important to pre-clean instruments before they're sterilized. Start by rinsing the instruments under running water to remove any large debris. Place all instruments, except the handpieces, in the ultrasonic cleaner and turn it on. While you're waiting, remove the tray liner and dispose of it in the appropriate waste. Thoroughly disinfect the tray. After the ultrasonic cleaner has finished its cycle, remove the cleaned instruments and rinse them under tap water. Place the wet instruments on a towel and gently pat to remove excess water. Sterile instruments should be packaged or wrapped to protect them from becoming contaminated after sterilization. The most common sterilization packaging options are self-sealing or heat-sealed bags and paper wraps. Package sets of instruments together as they'll be needed. Label each package with a sterilization date and method.
Do you want me to pause a little bit there, Irene, and then I'll...
Yeah.
I can go back to it.
Now we'll look at the sterilizing process itself. First, how to sterilize using an autoclave. To use the autoclave, place the pre-cleaned instruments in heat-resistant pouches. Most packaging has process indicators built in, but place an indicator into the bags if necessary. Put the packages in the autoclave, making sure to leave space between each item. Check and fill the fluid line with distilled water. Clean the sink with a disinfectant wipe. Wash the utility gloves, towel them dry, and place in the designated area. Wash and dry your hands, then shut the autoclave door. Run the autoclave cycle according to the manufacturer's recommendations.
Okay.
Yep.
So one of the things just that you saw in that video is the special gloves that the assistant was using. There's a very high risk of getting a sharps injury when you're manually cleaning those instruments. So usually they will have specific puncture resistant gloves that are used in the sterilization area so that you reduce the risk of getting injured.
Tadi teman-teman melihat ketika di dalam proses dental assistant mencuci alat-alat menggunakan sarung tangan berwarna hitam. Sarung tangan berwarna hitam ini khusus, dia tidak tembus tusukan. Jadi gunanya untuk melindungi tangan ketika mencuci agar ketika ada yang tajam-tajam itu tidak melukai tangan.
One of the things that you would have noticed is there's a very clear flow from dirty to clean as you do the whole sterilization process. And it's a strictly one-way flow. So you can't cross-contaminate instruments or anything like that. And this is a very simple diagram that shows that concept.
Hal lain yang kita bisa lihat tadi di video adalah adanya traffic flow yang satu arah sehingga tidak terjadi kontaminasi, mulai dari membersihkan hingga akhirnya ke steril. Seperti ini contohnya.
So you would start with the sharps disposal area, then you will move into the sink where you saw the person cleaning the dirty instruments, removing any visible debris. Then they were
placed. Kita akan mulai dari membuang sampah-sampah yang tajam tadi, lalu kemudian pergi ke wastafel di mana dental assistant tadi memakai sarung tangan yang berwarna hitam yang anti tusukan tadi ya.
Continue. Then they're placed in the ultrasonic cleaner, and then finally we start to move into the cleaner section. But remember, this, once they're removed from the ultrasonic cleaner, the instruments are still dirty and they're not okay to be used until they get packaged and put into the autoclave.
Kemudian sesudah dibersihkan dimasukkan ke ultrasonic cleaner. Yang perlu diingat adalah ketika kita keluarkan dari ultrasonic cleaner, barang-barang itu tetap masih kotor. Jadi sesudah itu kita masukkan di dalam kantong-kantong dan kemudian harus dimasukkan ke dalam autoclave.
And then finally, as they get through the whole flow, on the other end, you'll have all these instruments that are ready to be put away and kept clean. So you can use a similar traffic flow diagram in whichever practice that you're working with, and you can show your staff so they all are aware of how this works.
Jadi flow ini juga bisa kita pakai dan kita ajarkan ke staff sehingga mereka bisa menggunakan cara yang sama.
So now we're going to move into a very important aspect of clinical practice, which is hand hygiene. And again, I want to share with you another small video which shows you why it's so important.
Kita akan melihat video mencuci tangan.
So I think that's quite a useful little video which shows you how important hand hygiene is, because a lot of the time as dentists, we've got gloves on and we think everything is clean. But as you can see from that video, there's a lot of things that we can't see and there's a lot of potential for contamination to occur. All Okay. And so from the video, there are five moments of hand hygiene that should be followed. And this is by the World Health Organization. The first is before you touch a patient. The second is before you actually conduct a procedure. The third is after you finish that treatment. Fourth, after you finish or after you've touched a patient before you're leaving. And then finally, after touching any patient surrounding. So at each one of these times, you should be performing hand hygiene.
Ya, jadi video tadi menggambarkan betapa pentingnya kita melakukan cuci tangan setiap kali sebelum pakai sarung tangan, bahkan sesudah melepas sarung tangan, terutama juga karena tadi disampaikan sarung tangan itu sebenarnya berpori. Jadi semakin lama kita pakai juga semakin banyak kotoran-kotoran masuk dalam tangan. Karenanya WHO sendiri punya prosedur bagaimana harus mencuci tangan di setiap lima kegiatan ini.
So one of the classic issues that you saw in the video is where the doctor goes, he touches the patient, then he goes into a drawer to get something out without doing hand hygiene. And it's very similar in dentistry. You're doing the treatment and then you realize you need an instrument. You can't use the same gloves and then open the drawer and get stuff out of the drawer. It's important that you either remove your gloves, do hand hygiene, then get the instrument, or you've got a clean tweezer that you're using to pick things out with.
Ya, di tempat praktek kita juga sering seperti itu, sedang memegang pasien, terus kita ingat, oh ada instrumen yang saya perlu, lalu kemudian dengan tangan yang sudah pakai sarung tangan, kita biasanya buka lemari gitu ya. Nah, jadi harus dipikirkan apakah saya harus buka dulu gloves-nya, baru kemudian ambil barang itu dari lemari, atau kita siapkan tweezers khusus untuk mengambil alat-alat. Tweezers itu inset.
So this is quite important to also follow the structured hand washing protocol. As you can see here, there are certain areas that are very often missed during hand washing.
Dan ini adalah area-area yang sering terlewatkan ketika kita mencuci tangan. Jadi ini yang harus menjadi perhatian saat kita melakukan cuci tangan.
And the next thing is quite interesting because how long should you wash your hands for? Is it 30 seconds, 1 minute, 2 minutes? Does it depend whether you're washing with hand soap, hand sanitizer? Those are interesting questions that we should know the answers to.
Dan pertanyaan berikutnya adalah cuci tangan harus berapa lama? Pakai sabun kah? Pakai hand sanitizer kah? Nah, pertanyaan-pertanyaan ini akan segera kita jawab.
So if we look at the instructions from the World Health Organization again, on the left is for hand washing with soap, and on the right is for alcohol-based hand rub or hand sanitizer.
Jadi berikut ini di sebelah kiri adalah petunjuk dari WHO mengenai cuci tangan menggunakan sabun dan air mengalir, sedangkan yang di kanan adalah bagaimana menggosok dan membilas tangan ini menggunakan hand sanitizer yang berbasis alkohol.
And so what you notice is for hand washing with soap, usually that's done if your hands are visibly soiled. Otherwise, you use alcohol-based hand sanitizer. And if you're using soap, then the process should take 40 to 60 seconds, which is a relatively long time.
Jadi kapan sih kita harus mencuci tangan dengan sabun dan air adalah kalau kita dengan jelas-jelas kelihatan tangan kita kotor. Nah, mencuci tangan dengan air dan sabun itu membutuhkan waktu yang lebih panjang, yaitu hingga 60 detik.
And then if you're using hand sanitizer, it should be done for at least 20 seconds. And again, follow this protocol so that some area, you know, a lot of areas are not missed.
Dan kalau kita menggunakan hand sanitizer, kira-kira dipergunakan hingga 30 detik dan menggunakan peraturan yang ada di sini sehingga tidak ada satu area pun yang terlewat.
And there are a lot of different online modules that you can give your staff. And this is a free module from Hand Hygiene Australia, which over here we do every year. takes about 5 minutes to do, and you get a little certificate at the end of it, but it's a useful refresher to give your staff to do, you know, once a year.
Pemerintah Australia menyediakan online training hanya khusus untuk hand hygiene, dan mereka butuh waktu 5 menit untuk menyelesaikan modul ini, dan setelah itu dapat sertifikat. Ini learning modul yang bagus untuk meremind bagaimana harus menjaga kesehatan, kebersihan tangan.
Okay, so now let's move a little bit about COVID-19, and I'll just share with you some of my experiences and experiences here in Australia working and dealing with the pandemic. But remember, again, I'm not an expert on COVID or anything like that. I'm mainly just sharing experiences and some of the recommendations that we're following here.
Sekarang Dr. Jillian akan menyampaikan tentang pengalamannya seputar COVID-19, meskipun beliau mengaku bukan expertnya.
So we know that it is a viral infection from the coronavirus family. You know, to date, more than 7 million cases have been reported, over 400,000 deaths. And important to note that also, you know, more than 3 million people have recovered after contracting it as well.
COVID-19, kita sudah tahu keparahannya ya di seluruh dunia. 400,000 orang meninggal.
Specifically for us in dentistry, we know that it's got an airborne spread, and dental procedures have a high potential to produce aerosols and droplets that are going to be contaminated with these viral particles. And it's interesting that these aerosols are small enough to stay airborne for an extended period of time, after which they settle on environmental surfaces or enter the respiratory tract of staff and patients.
Ya, rute transmisinya bisa dari batuk, bersin, dan kemudian dari droplet dan aerosol. Dan di kamar praktek, aerosol ini bisa bertahan dalam waktu yang cukup lama sebelum akhirnya nanti dia jatuh ke permukaan benda.
So just to show you some of our restrictions that we had in place here, we're still operating at this level one restriction, which basically is the most basic level. And that means that we use standard precautions for all patients who do not have COVID risk factors. And if a patient has any COVID risk factors, then non-urgent dental treatment should be deferred.
Jadi ada peraturan di mana level 1 itu adalah orang-orang yang tidak beresiko terhadap COVID-19. Dan untuk orang-orang yang tidak beresiko untuk COVID-19 ini bisa dilakukan urgent dental treatment.
This is quite a good decision-making diagram from, again, the Australian Dental Association, which shows how we're working right now. And basically, the first step is triaging the patient over the phone to figure out whether they display any COVID risk factors. If they are low risk, then they can be treated under standard precautions. And again, I'll talk about this later. But if they're found to be at high risk or positive to COVID, then first we'll defer any non-urgent treatment. If there is urgent treatment, then that's going to be conducted under droplet precautions using N95 masks and so on, and I'll touch about this in a few minutes as well.
Dr. Jillian, I think you should explain first about triage because it's not common here.
Yep. Okay. I'm gonna have a slide on it later.
Ah, all right. Okay. Yeah. Jadi teman-teman, ini adalah decision tree untuk pasien level 1. Jadi kita mulai mensortir itu dari sejak telepon. Dari telepon, kemudian kalau dia low risk, maka kita akan rawat dia tapi dengan prosedur-prosedur yang sudah ditentukan. Dan kemudian kalau dia positif ataupun dia high risk, maka akan kita rawat menggunakan PPE misalnya maskernya harus yang N95.
And then we had level 2 restrictions, which is basically trying to aim to reduce any aerosols and again deferring any treatment that would generate a lot of aerosols.
Pembatasan yang kedua adalah membatasi semua tindakan yang kira-kira akan menghasilkan aerosol.
We were also, for luckily only a couple of weeks, we were on level 3 restrictions, which basically was a bit more strict. We're not allowed to generate aerosols and reserved any treatment for emergencies only, or patients who are at high risk of developing complications.
Pembatasan level ketiga yang dilakukan di Australia adalah mereka tidak diperbolehkan melakukan kegiatan yang menimbulkan aerosol, dan kemudian hanya boleh mengerjakan hal yang emergency.
And then level 4, luckily we haven't yet got to this, but it was similar to level 3, but a focus only on emergency treatment.
Pembatasan level 4 adalah hal-hal yang ditulis seperti ini. Untungnya mereka belum menemukan hal-hal yang seperti itu, tapi inilah pembatasannya.
But at least this table is useful because it gives you some examples of what to look for in your patient to decide how urgent their treatment may need to be.
Namun tabel dari ADA ini bermanfaat karena kemudian dokter gigi ketika menemukan diagnosisnya mereka punya panduan, oh kalau dia bleeding maka harus diapakan.
And then hopefully we never have to see level 5, but that's basically where no routine dental treatment is provided and all emergencies are deferred to tertiary centers.
Pembatasan yang level 5 adalah di mana tidak ada sama sekali kegiatan kedokteran gigi yang diberikan dan mereka sudah harus langsung diarahkan ke rumah sakit untuk emergency.
So, if we look a little bit about the whole process in specifically, the first thing is how do you book your patients' appointments? What we should do is screen and triage over the phone, and I'll talk about what this involves in a few slides. The next thing is to stagger your appointments so that there are long appointments which allow for additional cleaning and there's space in between the appointments so there's minimal patient traffic in the practice.
Kita kemudian akan membahas tentang bagaimana menjadwal pasien. Jadi Dr. Jillian akan membahas bagaimana melakukan screening dan triage melalui telepon, bagaimana mengatur jarak antar pasien.
There's no recommendation of how long the appointment should be. So it is obviously up to the practitioner. If they take, I don't know, 45 minutes usually for a certain procedure, you might want to keep that to 60 minutes to allow time for cleaning, hand sanitizing, and so on.
Tidak ada jurnal yang secara spesifik menegaskan berapa harusnya jarak antar pasien, tapi tergantung pada setiap dokter. Menurut Dr. Jillian, mungkin bisa 1 jam antar pasien, sehingga kita punya cukup waktu untuk bisa mendesinfeksi ruang praktek.
Some recommendations around booking patients. So for elderly patients or patients who have significant medical issues. Oh, 1 second, my battery. Sorry, just put the laptop on charge. So for patients that elderly, complex medical issues or immunocompromised, it's useful to delay any non-urgent dental treatment.
Saran, pasien di atas umur 70 tahun ataupun mereka yang punya penyakit penyerta dan punya penyakit yang melibatkan ketahanan tubuh rendah itu harus di undur penjadwalannya.
And then secondly, the patient should ideally attend alone, or if you're seeing children, they should generally only come in with one parent. And that again reduces the amount of traffic that's coming through the practice.
Saran yang kedua ketika kita mengatur pasien adalah pasien sebaiknya datang sendiri. Atau jika ditemani, ya minimal maksimal hanya boleh ditemani satu orang. Supaya mengurangi resiko dari kontaminasi.
Then when the patients actually present, they should use hand sanitizer at the reception area for 20 seconds at least. And if they haven't already been screened on the phone, then they'll be screened by the reception staff. And again, the temperature will also be checked.
Ketika pasien datang, maka pasien harus menggunakan hand sanitizer selama 20 detik. Dan kemudian jika sebelumnya belum di-screen dengan pertanyaan-pertanyaan melalui telepon, maka pada saat datang itu pasien bisa mengisi kuesioner. Kemudian juga harus dilakukan pemeriksaan temperatur.
So when it comes to screening, there's a certain number of questions that you can ask. We try and keep it fairly simple, so there's these three questions that we ask over the phone. Has the patient returned from any overseas or within the country travel in the last 14 days? Have they felt unwell and had any symptoms such as fever, cough, sore throat, or shortness of breath? Or have they had any contact with any confirmed or suspected cases of COVID in the past 14 days? And then if there's answer yes, then we should be delaying ideally routine care for at least 2 weeks.
Screening yang dilakukan dibagi menjadi tiga pertanyaan. Jadi mereka berusaha membuat screening ini as simple as possible. Pertanyaan pertama adalah apakah pasien baru datang dari luar negeri atau luar area dalam 14 hari terakhir. Kemudian pertanyaan kedua, apakah saat ini pasien merasa tidak enak badan? Apakah ada batuk, ada demam, ada sakit tenggorokan, atau nafasnya pendek-pendek? Pertanyaan yang ketiga adalah apakah pasien berkontak dengan orang yang menderita COVID ataupun diduga menderita COVID dalam waktu 14 hari terakhir? Jika salah satu jawabannya iya, maka tunda.
And then we've all heard about this concept of social distancing. So we need to try and accommodate for this, obviously, in the dental practice as well.
Dan kemudian praktekkan social distancing. Jadi demikian pula di waiting room, kita beri jarak satu orang dengan orang lain sekitar 1.5 meter.
So ideally also with your patient bookings, you don't want to have multiple people in the waiting room because you ideally just want the patient to come straight from their car or walking straight into the practice without having to wait too much, because otherwise it's potentially increasing the risk.
Jadi dengan sistem booking pasien, maka idealnya pasien itu turun dari mobil langsung masuk kamar praktek, bahkan tidak perlu menunggu di waiting room, karena menunggu di waiting room juga meningkatkan risiko penularan.
A couple of things that have been recommended is one, to remove any unnecessary items like toys and magazines, anything that different patients would be touching. Adjust seating in the waiting room to accommodate at least 1.5 meters between the seats. Regularly wipe down the surfaces with disinfectant wipes, including door handles, desks, and phones. And otherwise use any other hospital grade disinfectant.
Di ruang tunggu, semua barang-barang yang akan sering disentuh-sentuh pasien seperti mainan, majalah harus dihilangkan. Kemudian pengaturan duduk berjarak 1.5 meter antar kursi. Kemudian setiap permukaan itu harus dibersihkan dengan sedikitnya 60% alkohol base atau H2O2. Yang harus dibersihkan adalah pegangan pintu, meja reception, telepon. Atau kemudian menggunakan juga desinfektan yang biasa digunakan untuk di rumah sakit.
And then when the patient actually is in the chair, again they will use a hand sanitizer again before they sit into the dental chair, and you can give them a pre-procedural mouth rinse for at least 20 seconds.
Kemudian ketika pasien duduk di kursi dental, maka berikan hand sanitizer dan mereka harus mencuci tangannya selama 20 detik. Kemudian minta mereka untuk berkumur, bisa menggunakan hidrogen peroxide maupun povidone iodine.
So these are the recommended mouth rinses from the Australian regulations, which essentially says any mouthwash. But if you look at the literature around it, the use of chlorhexidine is probably a bit questioned because it may not actually effectively kill coronavirus. So particularly the American guidelines and things will suggest using oxidative agents because the virus is prone to oxidation. So 1% hydrogen peroxide or povidone iodine.
Bahan yang kita bisa lihat di slide itu adalah bahan yang direkomendasi oleh pemerintah Australia. Namun dari jurnal penelitian kita tahu bahwa 0,2% klorhexidine obat kumur tidak bisa menghilangkan virus. Karenanya kalau di Amerika mereka hanya menyarankan menggunakan hidrogen peroxide maupun povidone iodine.
Perfect. So now we just move on to, oh, I'm not sure what is happening. One second. Managing aerosols.
Sekarang kita akan bahas tentang bagaimana mengendalikan aerosol.
Is there a lot of scribbles on your screen, Irene, that you can see, like blue and
yes,
green?
Yes, correct.
I don't know how that is happening. I'll try and, one sec, I'll just try and come out of this. Is it from Zoom?
I think...
Oh,
is
yeah.
It not from Mac?
Zoom, one second. I just clear it. There you go. Okay. Oh no, it's doing it again. One second. It's from Zoom.
It's annotated. From the Zoom.
Yeah, that's okay.
So you mean they're drawing something like that?
No. I think it's my computer is accidentally pressed. There you go. Okay, perfect. So now we need to just look at managing aerosols because this is a big issue in dental practice. One thing to understand is there's aerosols and there's splatter, and both are slightly different depending on the dimensions of the particles. So aerosols are very, very small particles, less than 50 microns. And they have the potential to stay in the atmosphere for extended periods of time before then settling down. Whereas splatter particles that are greater than 50 microns, and they almost have like a ballistic projection. So it's like an arc. They hit something like a surface and then, or they just land on the ground eventually quite quickly.
Sekarang kita akan membahas mengenai aerosol, dan aerosol ini merupakan hal yang sangat kritikal di dalam kamar praktek. Ada dua istilah, yaitu aerosol dan cipratan. Bedanya adalah kalau aerosol itu ukuran partikelnya lebih kecil dari 50 mikron. Dan karena dia kecil, dia ringan, dia bisa melayang-layang beberapa waktu sebelum akhirnya dia jatuh ke permukaan. Kalau cipratan itu ukurannya adalah lebih dari 50 mikron dan arah cipratan itu seperti tembakan pistol gitu ya. Jadi seperti balistik. Nah, jadi dia akan terlontar kemudian jatuh di permukaan.
So one thing about aerosols is because of their small size, they can be present in the air for up to 30 minutes after a procedure. So you can imagine you finish your procedure, you take off your mask, and you're talking to the patient. There is a strong potential for you to be inhaling those aerosols.
Nah, aerosol itu karena saking ringannya, dia masih bisa berada di udara sekitar 30 menit sesudah kita selesai dengan prosedur kita. Jadi bayangkan kita udah selesai, kita buka masker, kemudian kita berbicara dengan pasien. Nah, disitulah kemungkinan kita menghirup aerosol tersebut.
So what sort of dental equipment generates aerosols? We'll just go through those a little bit. The most obvious is ultrasonic cleaners, and they have the greatest potential for aerosol contamination. Which is why in our recommendations, it's one of the first things to avoid with the whole COVID pandemic, especially non-urgent sort of scale and cleans. We try and avoid that because of the aerosol contamination.
Nah, alat yang paling besar mengeluarkan aerosols adalah ultrasonic dan phonic scalers. Jadi, untuk masa COVID ini, kalau tidak terpaksa, tidak boleh digunakan.
Then the second is air polishing. So things like Profi also will generate a lot of aerosols, almost the same as ultrasonic.
And hal yang then kedua adalah pemolesan. Pemolesan itu juga menghasilkan aerosol yang sama banyaknya dengan ultrasonic scaler.
And then obviously the air and water or the triplex syringe will also generate quite a lot of aerosol. And then finally the handpiece. And there's a couple of points that you notice in this table. They talk about high volume evacuation and the use of a rubber dam. So I will talk about those aspects in some detail.
Hal yang ketiga adalah three-way syringe. Jilan, can yes. I ask first? About the air water syringe, what does it mean? We cannot use those triple syringes.
You can use all of these. It just means that these things are high risk of generating aerosols.
And the high risk is when we press air and water together, or air alone, water alone?
Air and water together. Even water, with water, it'll generate larger droplets. With air and water, it'll generate aerosols.
Okay. Jadi yang nomor tiga yang beresiko tinggi juga mengeluarkan aerosol adalah kalau kita mencet three-way syringe, terus kita pencet air sama udara barengan. Nah, itu menghasilkan aerosol. Nah, kalau kita hanya pencet airnya saja, itu menciptakan droplets, gitu ya. Dan kemudian yang keempat, yang beresiko juga mengeluarkan aerosol adalah ngebor dan air abrasion. Dan kemudian di tabel ini, tadi disebutkan ada harus ada penggunaan high volume evacuator dan rubber dam. Nah, itu sebentar lagi akan dibahas.
So none of this is saying that you shouldn't use any of these things. It is just there to for you to understand that all of these equipments will generate aerosols. And when you see your patients, you have to identify their risk and your risk of generating aerosols. So you may want to limit the use of some of these depending on the patient risk. It's not that you can't use it.
Jadi alat-alat yang ditulis di sini bukan berarti kita tidak boleh pakai, cuman kita diberi pengetahuan bahwa penggunaan alat-alat ini berisiko sangat tinggi menghasilkan aerosol. Karenanya ketika kita mengambil keputusan bahwa saya akan menggunakan, yang harus kita hitung adalah resiko saya sebagai dokter, dan kemudian yang kedua adalah resiko pasiennya.
So now pretend that we have generated a lot of aerosols. How do we remove these aerosols? There's two methods that you can use. One is removing contaminated material from the air after it's already become airborne. And the other is to remove contamination before it leaves the operation site. So if we're already, if we're trying to remove aerosols that are already in the room, then you would be looking at things like HEPA filtration or UV systems. Whereas if you're looking at how to remove a bulk of aerosols before they actually leave the oral cavity, then we will be looking at high volume evacuators or suction.
Bagaimana mencegah airborne contamination? Ada dua cara. Nomor satu, membiarkan airborne ini keluar dulu ke ruangan dan kemudian kita harus berarti memasang HEPA filter dan UV. Atau sebelum dia keluar dari mulut pasien, kita sedot dulu dengan high volume evacuator.
So it's quite important that the first aspect there, if you've already got contaminants in the room, it's actually very, very difficult to remove them. And, you know, HEPA filtration system and UV systems are actually very, very expensive. And you have to look at the dynamics of airflow in your practice, how air travels through ducts, air conditioning systems, the time that it would take for certain amounts of air to be treated by things like UV. So generally, those systems are not commonplace in most practices because to do it properly, it's very expensive to set up.
Pilihan yang pertama tadi, membiarkan aerosol keluar dan kemudian baru kita sibuk sedot dengan HEPA, dengan UV, itu adalah pilihan yang mahal, nomor satu. Dan kemudian kita tidak bisa menangani semua aerosol itu karena dia akan terbang kemana-mana. Jadi, pilihan yang pertama ini bukan pilihan yang ideal dan biasanya tidak digunakan untuk di Australia.
So the most common approach then is using high volume evacuator or suction.
Jadi yang paling masuk akal adalah menggunakan high volume evacuator atau suction.
So you, most of you would have used this in practice, which is low volume evacuator or a saliva ejector. And, you know, it can be easily bent and used by one person if you need to.
Nah, and yang sering kita gunakan adalah saliva ejector. Saliva ejector ini bisa digunakan sendiri karena bisa ditekuk gitu ya. Saliva ejector ini termasuk low volume evacuator.
So on the left, you have now high volume, and on the right, you have low volume, just as an example.
Nah, ini adalah gambar yang sebelah kiri itu adalah high volume evacuator. Kalau yang sebelah kanan adalah low volume evacuator.
If you look at what this looks like in practice, you can see the difference in effectiveness between the two. A high volume removes up to 100 cubic feet of air per minute. And you can see even the bore volume, the size of the hole, the size of the pipes are bigger. And in the picture above, the same amount of water in a beaker, and you can see how much a high volume will clear versus low volume.
Bedanya low volume dan high volume adalah satu, diameternya sudah berbeda. High volume punya diameter yang lebih besar. Dan kemudian high volume ini bisa mengangkat 100 cubic feet udara per menitnya. Bisa menyedot.
So usually when you're using a high volume evacuator, it's best to have a four-handed approach, which means it's best to have the dental nurse or assistant hold the evacuator and follow the dentist as they go around the tooth. And the aim is just to position that evacuator as close as possible to remove as much spray as possible.
Ketika menggunakan high volume evacuator, maka pendekatannya adalah four-handed dentistry. Kita harus punya asisten untuk bisa memegang dan memposisikan HVE ini. Dan caranya adalah meletakkan HVE sedekat mungkin dengan sumber aerosol tersebut.
And then the next thing that is very useful for any restorative procedures is rubber dam, which has shown to reduce the chance of bacterial airborne contamination by 70%.
Hal lain yang bisa mengurangi airborne contamination adalah menggunakan rubber dam.
So if we look at all the various methods just as a summary of how you can manage aerosols, the first is obviously personal protective equipment, and I'll talk about that in a second. The second would be using pre-procedural mouth rinses. Now, remember, this is just routine practice. If we're looking at the COVID context, like I said before, rather than use chlorhexidine, you would consider something like a peroxide-based mouthwash. Then use high-volume evacuator, and plus or minus, if you can, HEPA filtration or UV treatments of your rooms.
Jadi ini adalah tabel standar prosedur yang dilakukan di Australia, tentu sebelum masa COVID, karena sesudah COVID ini, mereka antiseptik mouthwash-nya tidak lagi menggunakan klorhexidin, karena klorhexidin tidak bisa mematikan virus. Tapi ini adalah peralatan yang merupakan prosedur standar di sana, yaitu personal protection, kemudian pasien harus berkumur, kemudian menggunakan high volume evacuator. Yang terakhir, boleh tidak ada karena harganya mahal, itu adalah seperti misalnya HEPA dan UV.
So when we look at personal protective equipment, we should all be familiar with these things, PPE. So it's protective glasses, masks, gloves, face shields, and protective outerwear with general precautions.
Jadi yang disebut dengan perlindungan diri atau istilahnya adalah PPE kalau di luar negeri, personal protective equipment, itu terdiri dari baju yang kita pakai, terus apa yang akan melindungi mata, apa yang akan kita gunakan untuk masker, untuk sarung tangan, dan kemudian juga face shield.
So this primary protection, it's generally what you would be using every day. Whether there's COVID or no COVID, usually this is something that we do in dental practice. You use a specific clothes or coat or something, glasses, masks, and gloves.
Jadi ini adalah PPE yang biasanya digunakan sehari-hari. Ada COVID, nggak ada COVID, ini yang dipakai gitu ya. Jadi pakai penutup kepala, pakai surgical mask, pakai working clothes, pakai goggles atau face shield, dan kemudian pakai sarung tangan.
And then if you're working in a slightly higher risk environment, especially in hospitals, then that you can add things like disposable clothing like scrubs and disposable shoe covers and things like that, for example.
Oh. Sorry, salah nerjemahin ya. Tadi yang di atas itu surgical mask, jadi masker. Kalau kita bekerja di rumah sakit, maka dilengkapi lagi dengan surgical clothes.
And then finally, if we're dealing with much higher risk patients, although they're unlikely to be seen in a dental clinic, especially with COVID, because ideally you would defer any of this treatment, you would also include specific droplet or aerosol precautions, including a N95 respirator.
Kemudian PPE untuk level 3. PPE level 3 ini mungkin tidak dilakukan di dental clinic ya. Tapi PPE level 3 adalah penutup kepala, surgical mask, masker ya, working clothes, goggles atau face shield, sarung tangan, surgical clothes, penutup sepatu, dan respirator N95 atau masker N95.
Probably a better image is one of these, because these are specifically for COVID, these images. So you notice that a lot of different organizations, the top on the right is Center for Disease Communication in the US. There's images from the public health system in the UK. So different regulations will have different requirements.
Ini adalah berbagai regulasi dari berbagai negara. Mereka punya beda-beda peraturan karena punya requirement yang beda-beda juga.
So yeah, it just depends, I guess, what the Indonesian government has regulated in terms of what you should and shouldn't wear when dealing with patients that are COVID at risk or not. But either way, especially for me in pediatrics, we are dealing with young children. And now with the whole COVID situation, they're seeing health practitioners and dentists with all these masks and gloves and gowns, and it can be quite scary for little kids because they're not sure what is going on.
Kita di Indonesia mestinya mengikuti arahan dari pemerintah untuk apa yang harus kita pakai. Nah, Dr. Jillian sendiri karena dia pediatrik, dia melihat bahwa pasien anak-anaknya ketika pergi ke dokter gigi itu menjadi ketakutan karena melihat perlengkapan dan PPE yang dipakai oleh dokter giginya.
So specifically for little kids, because I work in the children's hospital, our hospital made a little video for children to see so that they are not intimidated by seeing the staff in different clothing. And I'll just share that with you now.
Jadi, Dr. Jillian bekerja di rumah sakit anak-anak. Di sana diputarkan video sehingga anak-anak tidak terkonsentrasi melihat baju yang dipakai oleh tenaga kesehatan.
You'll see a lot of uniforms when you come to PCH.
Our uniforms show what we do.
We have nurses, doctors, patient support workers, medical imaging, allied health, and pharmacy staff.
You may have noticed posters of our child health heroes around PCH. They are everywhere.
At the moment, we have a different looking health hero.
Our staff wearing personal protective equipment, which we call PPE. Because just like comic book heroes, special missions require special equipment.
They wear a gown, masks, and gloves.
It's kind of like a superhero suit. It helps us protect and look after you and our staff by fighting off germs and things like coronavirus.
When you see us in PPE, remember, we may look different, but it's still us underneath.
You may not be able to see me smile, but it's still here, see?
So that's just a little video, just so you know, to show the kids that actually there's nothing scary, you know, behind all of that.
Jadi itu adalah video yang dibuat di rumah sakit anak tersebut hanya untuk menunjukkan bahwa tidak apa-apa, tidak menakutkan.
Now another video that I want to show you, which is actually very, very important, because where aerosols and contamination can occur is when you're taking off and putting on PPE. So it's important to understand how the process works, what you should take off when, and how you should do it. So I'll show you this video now.
Berikut ini adalah cara memakai dan melepas PPE karena cukup critical juga untuk dipahami.
Oh, the process, by the way, is called donning, which means putting on, and doffing, which means taking off.
Istilahnya adalah donning dan doffing. Donning itu adalah memakai, doffing itu adalah melepas.
So this is specific for treating patients that are at risk or COVID positive, not every single patient.
Ini adalah penggunaan untuk menangani pasien yang sudah jelas positif COVID. Jadi bukan untuk semua pasien.
Because here you can see they're using N95 respirators and they're doing a fit check, which means covering the mask, blowing in it gently, and checking to see if any air escapes.
Jadi ini adalah cara menggunakan N95, ditiup sehingga dia menggembung, kemudian dicek apakah sudah fit letaknya pada hidung.
We don't normally use two pairs of gloves, but they're using it in this case and in this other hospital.
Kita tidak biasanya menggunakan dua lapis gloves, tapi di sini digunakan.
We've done the aerosol generating procedure, and it's effectively the removal of the gloves and the gown, and then we will do the rest in the ante room. So if you follow my lead, as per the doping instructions, and you grab the anatomical snuff box, and just pull the first glove off, and then slide your fingers underneath the second glove, and all in one without touching the outside. Straight into the bend. And then because we're double gloving for this procedure, we repeat the same process. So anatomical snuff box, glove, pull the glove off in one hand, and then slide your fingers underneath, never touching the outside of the glove, and straight in. Tell us, do you mind, so that we don't have to touch it. That's great. Thank you. And now we're going to try and doff our aprons without touching the front of them, which is tricky, but we will do the best that we can. So hands behind necks and pull the first attachment, and hands behind back and pull the second attachment. And then if you reach behind and from the inside, you're not touching the outside, and you start to roll from the inside, roll from the inside, roll into a ball, and straight into the bin. So guys, there's one more thing in here before we leave. We need to get rid of the visors. Okay, doffing the visors, hands behind head. If you've got these ones, you pull the strap forward, lean over and just let it drop. So for the next stage of doffing, we do in the anteroom. So we'll get Savas to open the door so we don't touch anything until we're back into the anteroom. So now with the FFP3s, what I want you to do is take the nape of the neck strap and bring it up to the other strap. So you've got both straps together, and then you're going to lean over the bin, leaning forward, bring the strap over your head and let the mask just drop so you never touch the front of the mask. Lean forward and let it drop with gravity. The last thing we need to do is the hat, so fingers on the inside so we don't touch the outside, lift it off, and then into the bin without touching the outside of the hat. And then we are going to wash our hands with warm water and soap.
So you can see that procedure. The removal of gloves and gowns is important because you shouldn't at any point touch the outside surface. And same thing with your disposable cap. You want to make sure, because that's been collecting a lot of aerosols through the day, that you don't just take it and fling it off. You have to very carefully put it into the bin.
Jadi yang paling penting ketika memasang maupun melepas adalah jangan menyentuh permukaan luar. Dan kemudian saat memakai atau melepas N95 juga harus memegang talinya, baru kemudian dilepaskan dengan hati-hati.
So this is the sequence of putting on the PPE. So you'd put the gown on, your mask on, check the fit of the mask, then protective eyewear, and then finally the gloves.
Jadi ini adalah urut-urutannya. Nomor satu memakai gaun, nomor dua memakai masker dan memastikan fitnya masker ke hidung, kemudian memakai face shield, baru terakhir adalah memakai sarung tangan.
Now is a very important thing because we've seen a lot of issues in the public, on the media, around the use of masks. So I just wanted to touch a little bit about the different types of masks, because you may have a false sense of security if you've got a mask on and you're not using the right mask for the right job.
Sekarang kita akan membahas masker, karena masker cukup penting dan menjamin keamanan kita.
So usually the ones that we would be recommending for COVID positive situations is something called an N95 respirator. And you can see from the table, what that does is it filters 95% of all particles greater than 0.3 microns.
Di Australia, untuk penanganan pasien yang positif COVID-19, mereka menggunakan N95. Dan arti dari N95 adalah mampu memfilter lebih dari 95% partikel ukuran 0,3 mikron.
Now, one thing that's very interesting is there is a reason why the 0.3 microns is chosen. And that is normally referred to as the most penetrating particle size. Particles that are above this in size move in the way that we could anticipate. So, you know, if it's a big particle, it'll go in a trajectory and hit a surface or whatever. But if it's particles smaller than 0.3 microns, they have something called a Brownian motion, which actually makes them easier to filter. And it's because the particle is so small, if it's less than 0.3 microns, that it starts to interact with components or molecules in the air. So they don't just go straight. They might go in a funny motion, erratic pattern. So 0.3 microns is a chosen size, the most penetrable particle size.
Tiga mikron itu disebabkan karena dengan pertimbangan begini, partikel-partikel yang lebih besar itu jalannya adalah seperti proyeksi tembakan. Dia seperti lintasan parabola jatuhnya. Sedangkan kalau partikel yang lebih kecil dari 0,3 mikron, dia itu bisa terbang, dan terbang ini arahnya suka-suka dia, jadi kita nggak bisa lihat dan nggak bisa memprediksi dia akan terbangnya ke sebelah mana.
And so you'll be able to see that there's different grades of masks. Even surgical masks come in different levels, and the standards are slightly different in each region.
Karena itu ada berbagai level dari masker, dan bahkan di berbagai negara punya standar yang berbeda-beda.
Now, the other thing is, how long can you wear a mask for? Because there's a very interesting study, and normally the manufacturer's instructions will also give a time period. Because after, you know, about 2 hours or 1.5 hours of wearing the same mask, there is a strong potential for the mask to be almost the same as having no mask, because it starts to wick moisture and allow bacteria to penetrate through.
Dr. Jilan, can you repeat?
So different masks have different instructions on how long they can be used for. And mm-hmm. usually, as you can see in this graph, after 1.5 or 2 hours, your standard 2-ply mask will almost be the same as having no mask, because mm-hmm. it allows penetration of bacteria through it.
Oke, masker yang teman-teman pakai itu mestinya ada petunjuknya berapa lama dia bisa digunakan. Pada tabel ini menunjukkan penggunaan masker yang 2 lapis setelah 30 menit, itu setelah 1,5 jam dan setelah 2 jam, itu meskipun dipakai itu tidak ada gunanya karena sama saja dengan tidak memakai masker.
Two things to remember here is this study was looking at bacteria, not viruses, and also different grades of masks will have different cutoff times.
Tabel Penelitian ini meneliti tentang bakteri, jadi dia tidak meneliti tentang virus. Dan kemudian setiap masker punya cut-off time yang berbeda-beda, punya batasan waktu pakai yang berbeda-beda.
The other thing, just while I'm talking about studies, right now, every 18 minutes, there's another study that gets published on COVID. So, and not every study is reputable. And it's important that if you're looking at studies that you read very carefully the methodology and understand the bias and how the study was conducted. Because just because it was published doesn't necessarily mean it is accurate.
Yang harus dipahami juga adalah saat ini setiap 18 menit ada saja tulisan mengenai COVID. Nah, kita harus melihat suatu penelitian itu bukan berarti kalau dia terpublish itu sudah pasti akurat. Tapi yang harus kita lihat ketika membaca jurnal adalah baca metodologinya, baca kemungkinan biasnya. Jadi artinya tidak semua jurnal mempunyai level credibility yang sama.
So we're almost finished, but I just want to share with you a few more points. These are some masks that are also N95 that you can get in a hardware shop, but they're not for us as health practitioners. They're for occupational health and safety working on construction zones. The biggest issue is they're not designed to deal with secretions or droplets, because as soon as they are subject to any moisture, that all that is going to get wicked inside the mask.
Ini adalah contoh masker yang kayaknya teman-teman juga sering ditawarin ya. Lihat di situ kodenya 8210. Meskipun ini masker N95, tapi ini gunanya untuk dipakai di industri. Karena masker ini tidak punya ketahanan terhadap cairan. Jadi sebentar dia kena kelembapan udara, dia sudah tidak bisa berfungsi.
So you can see here from 3M, they even wrote a letter saying, this is going back a while, but just showing you the differences between their own masks. And you can see that there is a difference between the same N95 mask. Certain ones are cleared for medical use, and the cheap ones that you can get at a hardware store are not recommended to be used for healthcare.
Jadi ini bahkan surat yang ditulis oleh company 3M, dan di situ dia sendiri menyebutkan bahwa masker N95 mereka ada beberapa macam, dan masker yang medical itu bisa tahan terhadap cairan. Sedangkan masker yang bisa kita beli lebih murah harganya itu tidak untuk dipakai di medis.
So I just want to leave you with two more slides that are my take home messages, if you like, from this presentation. The first are some mistakes that are often made with personal protective equipment.
Sekarang tinggal dua slide lagi, dan Jilen akan menyampaikan hal penting, yaitu kesalahan-kesalahan yang sering terjadi saat menggunakan PPE.
So things that you should not do is use more than, you know, use one mask for more than one patient. Use a mask for more than 2 hours. I've showed you that graph about bacterial contamination over time. Re-sterilizing masks, especially masks that are made from fabrics and things, they will degrade with time if you re-sterilize them. Cloth masks should not be used in healthcare practices because they offer very little splash protection or resistance from fluids. And you should also not use a face shield without also having a mask.
Ya, jadi ini adalah kesalahan-kesalahan fatal, tidak bisa dimaafkan, gitu ya. Nomor satu, menggunakan satu masker untuk lebih dari satu pasien. Jadi berarti satu masker untuk satu pasien. Kemudian yang kedua, yang tidak boleh dilakukan, satu masker digunakan lebih dari 2 jam, karena tadi kalau lebih dari 2 jam maka dia akses terhadap bakterinya sama aja dengan dia tidak pakai masker. Ketiga yang tidak boleh dilakukan adalah re-sterilisasi masker karena bisa mendegradasi masker. Keempat, yang tidak boleh digunakan adalah masker kain. Masker kain tidak untuk penggunaan di medis, karena tidak punya ketahanan terhadap cairan. Kemudian kesalahan yang kelima adalah menggunakan face shield, tapi tidak menggunakan masker.
Okay, and then just finally with management of COVID risk patients, these are some recommendations again from the ADA. It's ideal to try and schedule that patient as the last patient of the day and give them a surgical mask to put on prior to entering the building. And they should go straight from wherever they're coming from into the surgery and not into the waiting room. Ensure that all staff before being in practice are immunized against the current influenza strain, so having their flu vaccinations. Use the pre-procedural mouth rinse and spit in a cup rather than a spittoon. Minimize the use of aerosol techniques. Use a rubber dam and high-level evacuation. Place all disposable items into a separate bag, which should be sealed before going into general waste. And at least go through 2 complete cleaning cycles of all environmental surfaces using a detergent and disinfectant.
Jadi kesimpulan penanganan untuk pasien, terutama dalam masa pandemi COVID adalah nomor 1, perlakukan setiap pasien seolah-olah dia adalah pasien terakhir kita hari itu. Kemudian saat dia masuk, dia harus memakai surgical mask dan kemudian langsung duduk di kursi dental, bukan ke waiting room. Kemudian pastikan semua staf sudah terimunisasi. Kemudian pasien diminta untuk melakukan kumur-kumur 2 menit dan kumur-kumur tersebut dibuangnya lebih baik ke cup daripada ke spittoon. Lalu kerja dengan teknik yang seminimal mungkin menggunakan aerosol, menggunakan rubber dam dan high level evacuator karena ini bisa mengurangi aerosol. Membuang semua sampah ke plastik atau tempat yang berbeda lalu diseal, ditutup rapat sebelum dibuang ke pembuangan sampah yang lebih besar. Dan lakukan 2 kali complete cycles dari membersihkan permukaan dengan deterjen atau desinfektan. Jadi membersihkan ruangan itu dilakukan 2 cycle, 2 kali putaran.
Perfect. So thank you all for staying awake and bearing with me. I hope you found that to be of some value to you, and I really hope you all stay safe during this time. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you, Jilan. I think your explanation opened up our horizon a lot, and we couldn't thank you enough for spending so much of your time sharing your experience here. Do you still have time for question and answer, or you want
to... Yeah, I have some time. I have some time.
Oh, all right. So there's a question here. Is there any journal stating that the transmission of COVID-19 can be from dental clinics?
Yes, there's some papers that have been published on that. And there's very few, but there have been some cases also of transmission between dental staff. And the viral particles have been isolated also from saliva and salivary aerosols. So yes, there is some evidence around that.
Ya, jadi sudah ada bukti bahwa klinik gigi itu merupakan satu sumber penularan dan yang bisa menjadi sumber penularan juga adalah dental staff dan juga sudah ada penelitian di mana mengukur kandungan virus di dalam saliva dan itu sudah terbukti. Question number 2. When you receive a case with involving of pulp, can we do pulp opening? Because if we do pulp opening, we use burrs and it will create aerosol. So what would be the best to handle patient with abscess?
So the first thing is obviously you have to assess the risk of the patient. Is the patient, what sort of PPE are you going to use? If they're COVID risk, then you know you have to go through the additional precautions of the masks and so on. That's number one. The second thing is, depending on what level of restriction Indonesia is, will depend on what treatment you can perform. And then the third thing is, ideally, if you're going to minimize aerosols, then extraction of the tooth is going to be the least to generate aerosols. But if you have to do endodontic treatment, then it's ideal to you do that under a rubber dam and high volume evacuation.
Ya, jadi ada tiga hal yang harus diperhatikan. Nomor satu adalah resiko pasiennya dulu diukur. Apakah dia memang ada resiko COVID? Kalau dia ada resiko COVID, maka harus pakai PPE yang sesuai. Kemudian yang kedua adalah mengikuti peraturan di negara kita, apakah memang kita diizinkan untuk melakukan tindakan tersebut. Kemudian nomor tiga, kalau kita ingin mengurangi aerosol, maka memang pilihan pencabutan mungkin yang paling rendah aerosolnya, gitu. Tapi kalau kita ingin melakukan tindakan endodontik, maka harus menggunakan PPE yang sesuai.
The other thing that I can share with you is when we were in level 3 restrictions, we used a lot of teledentistry. So we would get the patients to send us photos from their home so they don't have to come inside. And we could try and assess them using, you know, images and over the phone. And then if possible, depending on the diagnosis, we would sometimes also prescribe antibiotics for the short term, just so that once the level 3 restrictions are lifted, then they can have proper treatment later.
Ketika Australia menetapkan pembatasan level 3, maka yang banyak dilakukan terhadap pasien adalah melakukan teledentistry. Jadi pasien mengirimkan foto ke dokter melalui mungkin WhatsApp gitu ya. Dan dokternya kemudian juga dapat memberikan antibiotika, resep antibiotika yang penggunaannya dalam waktu yang terbatas. Okay, third questions. For child patient, do we need to do rinse with hydrogen peroxide because the taste is not comfortable?
Yeah, that's a tricky one. So sometimes what we've been doing with, and the other thing is with very, very young patients, they often will not know how to spit properly. So depending on the child's function or capacity, sometimes you could do a swab. So you can dip some gauze into the mouthwash and you can swab the inside of their mouth and then dispose of that.
Salah satu cara untuk menangani anak-anak adalah menggunakan kapas yang dibasahi hidrogen peroxide, kemudian cuma di swab saja, cuma dilap saja di dalam mulut anak, hanya untuk mengurangi jumlah virusnya.
And remembering with that, it's not, you're not going to remove all the viral or bacterial load. It's just to try and reduce it. So you're doing as much as possible to try and reduce risk.
Jadi penggunaan obat kumur sebelum tindakan itu tidak bisa menghilangkan semua bakteri dan virus, tapi hanya mengurangi jumlahnya saja untuk berusaha menekan risiko. Ya, admin, apakah masih ada pertanyaan lagi? Oh, there is a question. In Australia, what is the restriction level now?
Now it's level one.
Level one means, dentists can practice routinely? Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
But we still limit all the, like the waiting room, the COVID screening, we still do all of that. But practice we can do, we're not restricted in terms of the treatment we can do.
Okay. There's a question. How is the activity of usage of aerosol suction machine? Extraoral aerosol suction.
Oh, extraoral. Yes, there's been a lot of advertisement around it. And I don't know of any studies that have looked at its effectiveness, particularly with viral aerosols. One thing that you have to be careful of is to ensure that the type of filtration that those extraoral suctions provide is actually what they claim it to be. Some will say that it filters everything, but actually when you look into it, it's not the real HEPA filtration that is required.
Okay, jadi belum ada jurnal yang meneliti efektivitasnya untuk aerosol suction tersebut. Another questions. We see here that many doctors has been used complete PPE, but they still get the disease. What would be the reason?
There's loads of ways of getting it. I mean, PPE is just trying to prevent the risk again. So, you know, if the area isn't disinfected or the way they've put the PPE on isn't correct, or if you're using masks for extended periods of time or the mask isn't sealed properly, loads of these sort of things can affect the risk. Or the doctor walks out of the hospital and there's patients that are COVID positive outside and he gets it from environmental exposures, or, you know, touching a door handle that hasn't been disinfected. So there's loads of other ways of getting the disease.
Yeah. Jadi meskipun dokter tenaga kerja sudah pakai, tenaga kesehatan sudah pakai APD, masih ada banyak cara untuk bisa ketularan, misalnya saat melepas, saat memakai, kemudian memakai masker terlalu lama, kemudian misalnya dia sudah selesai di tempat praktek, dia keluar dari rumah sakit, sudah nggak pakai PPE, ternyata di luar papasan dengan pasien COVID. Nah, itu juga bisa tertular. Jadi, ada begitu banyak cara untuk bisa tertular. Jilan, I think we have taken your time so long. Thank you so much for the precious lecture. This is very helpful for us in Indonesia. And I would like to say thank you from all of us. I think admin, apakah boleh di-unmute partisipan supaya bisa partisipan menyampaikan terima kasih juga kepada pembicara, begitu?
Perfect. Thank you very much.